very easily it is understood from the definition itself that a set of events are said to be exhaustive if it include all the possible events. If on the set all the possible outcomes are included, then that two events are known to be exhaustive events. Like in the case of this coin, if I say that A1 denotes getting the event, A1 denotes event of getting a head, and A2 denotes event of getting a tail, then obviously you know that if you look at A1 and A2 simultaneously, then you will get all your sample space included in these two events. Similarly, if I take any other example of die, so an example of die like this, in A there are elements like this, and in B these are the elements. Can you tell me whether A and B are exhaustive or not? First of all, are A and B mutually exclusive? So A and B are not mutually exclusive, but exhaustive. Are they exhaustive? Are A and B exhaustive? Comment fast. So what is the definition? They must include all your sample space. Yes. So if I look at sample space, there are six elements like this. If I look at A, then in A 1 is there, in B A 2 is there, in A 3 is there, and in A 5 is there. These are all your elements in A. Now what are the elements in B? In B we have again this 5, we have 6, and we have 4. Is my sample space covered up in these two events? So yes, you can see that there is no element left in the sample space which is not counted in any of these. So yes, A and B are exhaustive. If you look into the events A and B, and if you you can find out overall sample space from that A and B, that you can say that A and B are exhaustive. Okay, so we will say A and B are exhaustive. Understood or not? What you need to do, you just need to look at the elements of A and the elements of B. If you that together in all can give you sample space, then they set, then the particular set will be said to be exhaustive. Okay, understood? So now let's look at this Venn diagram for the exhaustive events. A and B are said to be exhaustive if they include all the possible outcomes in your sample space. So basically what that means is that if these many are elements in A, then the remaining element should lie in B. There should not be any element which is neither in A nor in B. Understood? So what can you tell about this event? We can tell about this event is that A union B should be equal to your sample space. What is union? Union means all those elements which belong either in A or in B or in both. So if you combine all those elements which are in A and B, if you are getting A union B as sample space, then they are said to be exhaustive. Or what will be the probability of A union B? What will be this probability? Yes, Chandan, very good. What will be the probability? Yes, obviously probability will be 1, because A union B is giving me sample space, means the favorable cases are whole sample space. So sample space divided by sample space gives 1. Yes? Any doubt? So these terms are very, very important. Now we are studying, so it is very easy to understand. But when these all concepts get mixed up, then it will become very difficult for you. Okay? Now we have already seen linearly independent vectors. Yes? In the last chapter, we have seen linearly independent vectors. What were these? when there is no relationship among the vectors, they are said to be linearly independent. That we have already done with the previous chapter. Now in this chapter we have independent events. Now what are independent events? If occurrence of one does not affect the occurrence of the other, then they are said to be independent events. Okay, write this down from the slide. Copy it down. Independent events, if occurrence of one event does not affect the occurrence of the other, it is known as independent. Now, let's again come back to that example where A and B were applying for a particular job position. Yes, I have told you about this case when we were studying mutually exclusive, that if A and B are applying for a job position and there is only one vacancy, then in that case, A and B will be said to be as mutually exclusive event. Now understand the difference here. The difference here is that now we have two vacancies. So what will happen? Whether A appears first or B appears first, or whether A's interview goes good or not, it does not anyhow affect the B person. Yes or no? It will not have any effect on the person B, because there are two independent vacancies. Both of them can apply for the post. Both of them can get the position also. Yes or no? So this kind of situation is the case of independent events, when the occurrence of one does not have any effect on the occurrence of the other event. Yes, if A's interviews went well, then B does not need to get worried or tensed or nervous, because he still have one chance, he still have one position to get that job. Yes? Okay, so one question for you, one small question. Question is, if I say that A and B are mutually exclusive, if A and B are mutually exclusive, then they will be reply. If it is given that A and B are mutually exclusive, then they will be dependent also, or independent also, or neither independent dependent, or you can't determine. What can you say about this? Remember the definition of mutually exclusive. What was mutually exclusive events? If A occurs, then B cannot occur. That was mutually exclusive. Or if B occurs, then A cannot occur. Yes or no? And independent means what? Independent means that occurrence of A does not affect the occurrence of B. Okay, it will not affect anyhow the occurrence of B. Now think about, are mutually exclusive events independent or dependent? So, yes, everybody has answered correctly. Mutually exclusive are dependent events, because if A occurs, B cannot occur. This is a kind of effect. Yes or no? If A is occurring, B cannot occur, means A, occurrence of A is affecting your occurrence of B. That's why this is not the case of independent events. This is the case of dependent events. Always mutually exclusive events are a set of dependent events. Understood? Understood or not? So definitely, we know that P probability of A intersection B for independent events will not be zero. Because if it were zero, that means they will be mutually exclusive. Yes. Now, what will be the relationship between the probabilities? Like for the impossible one, we had probability of event as 0. For the equally likely one, we had the probability of two events as same. For mutually exclusive events, we have the probability as what? Intersection of them is 0. And for exhaustive events, we have seen the probability of A union B is 0. Now, what is the relationship between the independent events? Can you guess? If A occurs, then B cannot occur. This is the condition of mutually exclusive. If A occurs, then B cannot occur. Okay, if I get selected for an interview, then you can't get selected for the same position. This is a kind of the effect which is I am generating on your outcome. Yes or no? So, I am affecting your position or affecting your future events. That's why I can say that I am not independent of your. You is not independent of me. You are dependent on me. That's why I've said that mutually exclusive is dependent events. Okay, so now independency means that one is not affecting the other. And let me take an example that on my one hand there is a coin and on the other I have a die. Okay, now if I define event A as getting head on the coin and event B as getting the number 6 on the die. Yes, I have defined two events. Event A is getting head on the coin and event B is getting 6 on the die. Are they independent or not? Are they independent? Are A and B here independent or not? Yes, definitely. Head can occur independently without having any effect of what has occurred on the die. Similarly, 6 number can occur independently without having any effect of whether head or tail has occurred or not. Yes, so these two are independent. Now, from here, we can conclude one thing that they are independent because this event sample space was head and tail and this event sample space was the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's why they became independent, because each of these events exist in different sample space, exist in different universe. That's why they do not have any effect on one another. Okay, so if I look for the Venn diagram for the case of independent events, then the Venn diagram will something look like this. So some sample space S1, some sample space S2. And A existing here and B existing there. Okay, so they exist in different sample spaces. That's why they are not affecting one another. Like, we do not get affected by aliens. Okay, because we and aliens are living in different universes. So this is the same logic. Any doubt? Write the definition and write the example. Okay, so I guess all everybody has understood what are independent, what are mutually exclusive. And yes, obviously now you can lie down for dependent events also. The events which are not independent or the events which are affected by the occurrence of the other are said to be dependent events. So very easy, write this down. For example, that one vacancy, two persons, and two vacancies and two persons. Now, if there is only one vacancy, either one of them can be selected, the other cannot be. So, if A is coming at this place, B cannot occur. What is this case? This is the case of mutually exclusive events. Okay. If A comes at this position, then B cannot come at this position. Understood? If A occurs, then B cannot occur. And for the cases of independent event, if A occurs at this position, then there is no foundation on B. It may or may not occur at this position. That means they are independent of each other. B is not depending upon A anyhow. If A's interview went well or not, it does not affect B anyhow. But here you can see the effect definitely. So law of addition. Let's go with this quickly. So basically, first of all, law of addition gives you write down, it gives you the probability of occurrence of either A or B or both. Basically, it is telling you the probability of A plus B. Now, A and B are not any variables. Yes, they are not the variables, or they are not some physical quantity. They are what? They are sets. They are sets. And if you remember your school level lessons, then you know that in terms of set, addition of set is written as what? It is written as union. Okay, so basically this law gives you the probability of A plus B, or basically probability of A union B. Now, you already know what do you mean by A union B. So, A union B denotes what? Elements which occur in A or B or both. Yes, so if I look at this Venn diagram, this is A, this is B, then what will be A union B? A union B is this red colored area. This total hatch area will be your A union B. Okay? And the common area, what do you mean by this common? Can you give me what is the term for this common area between A and B? What is that term? Yes, so common part is known as intersection. Okay, so we will talk about the intersection sometime later. Let's focus on here. I have not told you anything about this law, but I have told you one thing, that it gives you this probability. Okay, now for an example like this, if you do not know the law also, then also you can solve it. Okay, if I ask you what is probability of A union B, then what can you do? You can just find out the set which is A union B. Can you find out this set? Okay, let me remove this one. 6 from here. Okay, so can you find out what will be A union B? A union B, according to this definition, it is all those elements which are in A or in B or in both. So I'll write down the elements of A and B. So it will give me what? These many elements. Now you know A union B has these many elements. That means that for this required probability, how many favorable cases are there? So there are 5 favorable cases and total cases were 6. Answer is 5 by 6. So I have not used any law, but still you could find out the probability of A union B by just finding out what is A union B. So as simple as it. Now, if I take this example, and now again the same question to you, what will be A union B, probability of A union B. So what you will do again, you will just find out what is A union B. Now tell me, what are those elements in A union B? What are the elements in A union B? Reply fast for that example to A union B. Yes, so from this I got to know that you understand this thing, that if 5 comes in A and if 5 comes in B too, then also 5 will be only counted once in this union. Yes, you understand all of you understand this concept or not? Because this 5 is occurring both in both the sets, still we will count them in only one time. Why? Because it's the same thing. Like if you live in, let's say, Bangalore, and if you say I live in Karnataka, you are the same person. You will be counted once only. Okay, if you are living in A also and B also, if you are living in India also and Bangalore also, then too you are only single person. You can't be counted two times. Yes, so that is why in A union B also, you will count the 5 element which is common only one time. Now in this case, what is the probability of A union B? So 4 favorable cases divided by 6. let's not simplify right now. Let's write like this only 4 by 6. Understood? I think you understood this thing. Now, tell me in both these examples, what is the difference? What is the difference which I want to make in these two examples? All the things that you have done here is similar, that you have found out A union B and then you have calculated probability of A union B. But what is the differentiation between these two cases? And basically, can I say that in example 1, the A and B are which kind of events? And here, A and B here are mutually exclusive, while in that case, they are not mutually exclusive. That is the major difference that is occurring in both these two examples. Okay, so write down here that here A and B are mutually exclusive and here A and B are not mutually exclusive. When they are not mutually exclusive, that directly implies that there is some intersection. That means there is some common element between these two events. Yes? Not mutually exclusive directly implies that there is some element which is common to them, and that is why there is a difference. Now you can say that in this case, I can write this as PA plus PB. Okay, PA plus PB, but I will have to consider this 5 only once, because it is present only once in your union. While if you just add PA plus PB, 5 will be counted 2 times. So what you will have to do, you will just subtract this intersection part. Common part, intersection part. Have you understood this thing? Similarly, in this case, you can see here, you can directly write it. This is the same as PA plus PB and no subtracting anything, because here the elements or the sets do not have anything in common to them. So if 1, 3 and 5 are in A, so these 1, 3, 5 are counted in PA. Similarly, if 2, 4 are in B, so 2 and 4 are counted in B. So in PB, this will give you the probability of A union B if they are mutually exclusive. But if they are not, then there is some element counted twice when you add these two. So again, you will have to subtract the common part, which is the intersection. Got it or not? So this gives you the law of addition. So finally, we can summarize this thing, that law of addition is PA plus PB minus P intersection B. And for mutually exclusive case, you already know that intersection probability is 0. So for both the two cases, this will be the result. See, in probability chapter, there may be a lot of ways to solve a particular question. Like in this case, I have solved using my basic knowledge without applying any formula. And then sometimes you will have to use this formula to solve the question. So both the ways you should be able to understand. That's why I started with the basic concept, that what are we actually doing, so that you can apply this knowledge also sometimes, and then arriving at a formula like this. Done? So here we are required to find the product probability of A into B, and if you are familiar with the set theory terms, then AB means A intersection B. Now what does A intersection B means is elements which occur in what? Occur in both A and B. Those are the elements which are counted in the intersection part. So if I draw the Venn diagram again for such a case, so intersection is the common part, or the part which belongs in both A and B. So this hatch part is your intersection part. Okay, so this is actually what we need to find out. Now to find out this thing, we need to understand first of all what is known as conditional probability. Basically, we were looking for this probability, but we can't find out or we can't understand this term physically, that what is this physically or how can you arrive at this formula. So we can understand this thing very physically, so that we are first finding out this and then we will go into this law of multiplication. Now, conditional probability, what is it? So write down conditional probability. Probability of occurrence of A when B has already occurred. Very simple. Denoted like this. Probability of occurrence of A when B has already occurred, it is denoted like P A slash B, and it is read like this: probability of A given B. So now, like if we talk about cricket again, so as we know that earlier times, now Dhoni is not playing in ODIs, but when we knew that in ODI match Dhoni is still there to come, or Dhoni is still there to come, or means that he is still in batting order, then we have one faith in our mind that we can win the cup or win the match particularly. Okay, so that means that imposing some condition, or means having the Dhoni present in your team or not, have some effect on your winning probability. That is why always some event will be affected by the other one. Yes. So like in this case, if I say that B has already occurred, then what is the probability of A? Similar like to this, that if Dhoni is still there in the squad, then what is the probability of winning of India? So obviously, probability of winning of India without Dhoni in the squad and with him being in the squad is totally different. So that is what here it is. Conditional probability means some condition is already imposed, then what is the probability of some event? Okay, so to understand or to derive this formula of conditional probability, we will again take an example. So example is this, something like this, that again I have taken the dice and I have defined two events as two events. A event is the number being less than 3, and the event B as the event of getting an odd number. Now if I ask you that what is the probability of mistaken here. Okay, so A is the event of getting a number less than 3, and B is the event of getting odd numbers. Now if I ask you this probability, that probability of getting a number less than 3, provided that it is odd, provided that the number is not odd. So what do you understand from this statement is that you already know before even going with the experiment that the number should be odd. And now if I ask you what is the probability of getting a number less than 3, okay, so if I just ask what is the probability of getting a number less than 3 without this statement, provided that and all, then the answer will be 1/2. But as soon as I impose this condition, then the probability will definitely change. And how will it change? Let's look at that. So basically, first of all, in terms of mathematics, I can write down this statement as P A given B. When I am provided that B is, the number is to be odd, then what is the probability of occurrence of A? What is, that is known as conditional probability. Now how will I write it? Listen here carefully. How will I write it? Okay, I can see some answers here. Okay, less than or equal to, make it less than or equal to. less than or equal to. I'm just taking an example, so doesn't matter with the terminology, less than or equal to make it. What is happening? Listen here, I want to calculate this probability, but first thing I know is that the number will be definitely an odd number. So now tell me, if there are in the sample space, if there are these even number presents, will they have any effect on my experiment? So no. Why? Because I already know that the number should be odd. So in the sample space, these red circled numbers do not have any effect. So basically I can say that the sample space consists of only the three numbers 1, 3 and 5. Understood this thing? What I'm trying to say is, when I already know that B has to occur, that means other elements which are not in B does not need to be counted in the sample space. Okay, they do not contribute to the sample space for me, my experiment now, because I already know B is occurring. So B is occurring means my sample space gets reduced to the elements in B, which is 3. Understood? So in terms, I'll write down like this, elements in B. Okay. Elements in B. Now, what will be my favorable cases? So if you look at the elements carefully, I need the probability of getting a number less than 3 or equal to 3, provided that it is odd. So basically, it means that this number should be odd also, and this number should be less than or equal to 3 also. Yes or no? This number, favorable cases will be only those cases which are odd also and less than or equal to 3 also. That means what? That indirectly means that that should be a number which lies in this set and in this set. Then only the number will become less than 3 also and odd also. So what I can write here is that it is nothing but all those elements which are common to A and B. So elements in A intersection B, basically, you know, you can see that this answer will be 2/3. Yes, and if I divide these two, numerator and denominator, by the total elements in sample space, can I write this as PA intersection B divided by PB? So actually, we derived the formula for conditional probability without even using the formula. How did we derive? We just said that if you want to satisfy both the conditions, then your numerator should be what? The elements which are in both sets. That means A intersection B. And when you already know that B has occurred, then in the sample space, the other elements do not possess any significance now. So my sample space will now get reduced to just the elements in B, so that the denominator will become PB. Any doubt, if it's there, please ask me. So now, if it's clear, so now let's come back again to this. What we were looking for? We were looking for the probability of A intersection B. Now we have arrived this thing. I'm writing down here final formula. PA given B is PA intersection B divided by PB. And similarly, if you are looking for PB given A, then the sample space will now become your number of elements in A, and again the numerator will be the same, common to A and B. Okay, so these two terms we have actually derived now. Now we were looking for what quantity? We were looking for PA intersection B, this one. We were looking for this one. So we have actually arrived at it. So we can write the multiplication law like this, that it is equal to PB times PA given B, and it is also equal to PA times PB given A. give you that A and B are independent. Then can you tell me what will be this conditional probability of P A given B? What will be the value of this one? P A given B if A and B are independent. Think about it. If A and B are independent and whenever you are given some kind of events, just assume them to be those which I have given in the example. Like for mutually exclusive, I have given you A and B to be all even number and odd numbers. Similarly, for A and B, when they are independent, I have given you the example of a coin in one hand and a die in the other hand. So think about that example and tell me what will be this value. So whoever are answering P, A, they are absolutely correct. See, if A is getting head and B is getting 6, if A is getting head and B is getting 6, then what I'm asking to you is that what is the probability of getting a head when you know that you got a 6 on the other hand? This is what is asked. Okay, what I'm repeating again, probability of getting a head when you know that the number 6 has occurred. So will it be having any effect on it or not? It will not be having any effect. If it comes 6, if it comes 5, if it comes 1, it will not have any effect on the event of getting a head. The event of getting a head will be the same as it is. That means its probability will remain unchanged. It will be equal to PA. Yes, independent events, that's the definition only. If B occurred or not, A should not be affected. That's why PA given B will still be PA only. Similarly, if I ask you what will be B given A, then it will be PB only. Yes, therefore the multiplication law for independent events will be this as PA, so you will get this as PA into PB is 0 for mutually exclusive. If for independent 2 it came out to be 0, then how come independent will be mutually exclusive will be dependent events? We have already told you mutually exclusive will be dependent, so that is why for independent events the probability can never be 0. It will be always be the product of PA and PB. So I think you all have understood all these concepts. So let's start with the question marathon. So we'll be solving a lot amount of questions so that you get familiar with the concepts and how to apply those in the problem. So please solve each and every question very, very seriously. If you have any doubt, you can ask me now also and in the mail also. Okay. So let's start with the question. First question, try to solve it.